Greetings everyone, and today I'm revisiting a lens that I first tested about 6 years ago now, but this time on a high-resolution camera, the Sigma 35mm f1.4 Art. I was thinking of just testing it on my 42MP camera and showing you the test charts today, but when I looked at how old school my previous review was, I decided to completely retest it for you all, along with some comments on how this particular version for Sony E-mount cameras works practically too. If you're desperate to watch the old review, then there'll be a link in the description, and all I'll say is that, well, my reviews have thankfully improved over the years. I'll be using the same pretty sample pictures as before though, just for the sake of nostalgia. As Sigma's first lens of their big rebranding effort a few years ago, this piece of kit is very significant. It's the first of Sigma's art lenses, and it marks a deliberate move by them into the higher end market, a move which has been met with great success over the years. But despite its high quality, it costs only £600 in the UK, or just over $600. Those prices still greatly undercut those of the official equivalent lenses by Canon, Nikon, and Sony. So let's see if this slightly aging lens is still any good today. And I'd like to thank Sigma UK for loaning me a copy of this lens for a week for testing, although as usual, this is a totally independent review. The lens is for full frame cameras, where 35mm is a lovely standard wide angle, although not so wide that you can't get a nice little emphasis on your subject. This particular lens comes in Canon EF, Nikon F, Pentax K, Sony A, Sigma SA, L-mount Alliance, and tested today, Sony E-mount. The L-mount and Sony E-mount versions, as you can see here, are a bit longer than the originals for digital SLR cameras, as they have a built-in adapter to make them work properly on mirrorless cameras with the different flange distance. The gap from the rear glass element has been nicely flocked on the inside to prevent any extra reflections from sneaking in. The lens still has a weather sealing gasket though, and it's still fully electronic, optimised for the Sony E-mount. Despite having that built-in adapter though, the lens isn't actually much bigger than Sony and Samyang's competing 35mm f1.4 lenses, which are surprisingly big in themselves. At 750 grams, or 1.5 pounds, it's slightly on the weighty side, but it actually feels lovely on your camera with very solid build quality. The lens still uses the same ultrasonic autofocus motor as before, and the large rubberized focus ring is still mechanically coupled to the focus system, a bit of a novelty on a mirrorless camera lens these days. In use, the autofocus system worked only averagely quickly when shooting in stills mode, as you can see here, but it was accurate. As the motor turns, it emits a quiet whooshing sound, which will be slightly picked up by your camera's microphone when shooting video. In fact, the autofocus seemed to really slow down when shooting video on my Sony a7R II. The fact is that mirrorless camera systems seem to be much happier to work with efficient stepping motor lenses rather than the ultrasonic ones you tend to see on digital SLR designs. The in-body image stabilization on my camera cooperated with this lens perfectly, and the all-important eye autofocus feature also worked properly, so that's pretty important. The lens comes with a very nicely padded case and a hood, and its front filter size is 67mm. Overall, in terms of build quality, this lens is as good as ever. It feels solid, well-made, and lovely to handle. Its ultrasonic autofocus motor might not be to everyone's taste, and it's hardly quick off the draw, but it works perfectly fine. So, let's move on and see about the all-important image quality. As I mentioned already, this is the Sony E-mount version, so I'll start by testing it on a full-frame camera, my 42MP Sony a7R II. In the middle of the image, straight from f1.4, we see brilliant image quality right away, with excellent sharpness and contrast. Nice. Let's look in the corners. We see a little ghosting there, which lowers the contrast noticeably, but actually, resolution does manage to stay pretty high. We're still getting a decent amount of detail. stop down to f2 for that ghosting to largely go away, leaving us with a bit more contrast, and f2.8 looks almost perfect, and f4 actually perfect. The lens stays this sharp down to f11, and even f16 still looks good, despite a slight softening from the effect of diffraction. So, really, although this lens is getting a little older nowadays, its performance on full frame is still really impressive, offering great sharpness from corner to corner at all apertures, even on a 42 megapixel camera, and stopping down a lens's aperture a little makes it really fly. Nice. Well, let's see how it performs on a smaller sensor APS-C camera by mounting it onto my 24 megapixel Sony A5100. At f1.4, in the middle of your images, the lens still churns out some seriously impressive sharpness, although the eagle-eyed among you will spot just an edge of colour fringing here. I can tell you now that that goes away as soon as you stop down the aperture to f2. Let's look over in the corners. They look a little blurrier now, with some slightly stronger chromatic aberration being visible. Stop down to f2, f2.8, f4, and f5.6 for tiny gradual improvements which eventually lead to pretty sharp corner image quality. Again, the lens stays this sharp down to f11. So, on an APS-C camera, the lens is always mightily sharp in the middle of your images, although the corner image quality needs a bit of stopping down to really impress. Alright, let's take a look at distortion and vignetting on a full frame camera now. These images are taken without in-camera corrections. The lens projects just a negligible little hint of bevel distortion, nothing you'll notice in real life. The corners are very dark at f1.4 though. They brighten up somewhat at f2, and at f2.8, that vignetting is mostly under control. Still, you should definitely leave your camera's vignetting correction turned on. Now, let's see about close-up image quality. The lens can focus down to about 30cm, which is very useful for pictures of smaller subjects. At f1.4, close-up image quality manages to remain very sharp, albeit with a touch of purple fringing on contrasting edges. Stop down to f2 though, and we see absolutely perfect image quality here. That is a great performance. Now let's see how the lens works against bright light. It's a reasonably good performance here. We don't see too much in the way of flaring, although obviously the lens isn't totally resistant to it, as you can see. While we're working in the dark, let's take a look at coma levels. At f1.4, in the corners of your images, bright points of light do display some quite clear coma smearing, as you can see. At f2, it's reduced, and at f2.8, it's gone. Now, let's take a look at this lens's bokeh. As you can see from these sample pictures, no serious problems here. The bokeh is consistently decently soft. I have seen softer out-of-focus backgrounds than this before, but there's never anything disturbing or busy going on, so that's pretty pleasing. And finally, related to bokeh is longitudinal chromatic aberration. At f1.4, we can definitely see some pink and green bokeh highlights around the plane of focus there on close inspection. However, stop down to f2 to see it largely gone, and at f2.8 completely gone, so that's not a bad performance either. Well then, overall, back when I first tested this lens 6 years ago, I found it to be as impressive as it was likeable, and that's still the case today. Its image quality is still great, even on a more modern, higher resolution digital camera, and it's still great fun to use. My only real gripe with it is that its autofocus is a little slow on the Sony E-mount version I tested, although it was a bit faster on a Canon EF mount version of the lens when I tested that one way back. But really, it still offers fantastic image quality and build quality at a very reasonable price, and so owners of Sony E-mount cameras should see it as a serious option, and even 6 years later, it still comes highly recommended.